Good afternoon and welcome everyone to today's release of Resources for the Future's Global Energy Outlook 2024, Peaks or Plateaus. I'm Richard Newell, I'm the President and CEO of Resources for the Future. We're an independent nonprofit research institution working to improve environmental, energy, and natural resource decisions through impartial economic research and policy engagement. Really pleased to have you here today, particularly because this is my last public event, probably, as RFF president. This has been news for a while, but if you haven't heard yet, the RFF board recently chose Billy Pizer as my successor, effective May 1. So RFF will be in great hands, and I know that Billy's here in the audience. Billy, raise your hand. So let's give Billy a round of applause. We have a great panel for you here today. In addition to the audience here in the room, we've got several hundred people online joining us. The event will focus both on an analysis of the 2024 Global Energy Outlook, as well as a discussion with an expert group of panelists around the potential implications. The Global Energy Outlook is RFF's signature annual report, synthesizing a range of different outlooks from different governmental and non-governmental energy institutions, including companies across the world. This is actually the eighth iteration of the Global Energy Outlook. It's something we started about a decade ago, shortly after I finished my time as the administrator of the Energy Information Administration, and it was becoming clear that both policymakers and the private sector needed an authoritative, independent source of information that brought all the different viewpoints about the energy future together, did it on an apples-to-apples comparative basis, and made that available to the public for free. And so I'm pleased to serve as a co-author of the report, together with my colleagues Daniel Ramey, Yuqi Zhu, and Brian Prest. You'll hear more from them in a minute. As they talk about this year's findings shortly, and then we'll follow up with a distinguished panel of experts who Daniel will introduce when he gets up here. We'll be leaving time at the end for Q&A, both from you here in the audience online. Thanks for folks who put in questions in advance online. We always appreciate that. Another quick note, thanks to all of RFF supporters. It's your support that makes events like this possible. The work like the Global Energy Outlook possible, and if you're not yet a supporter, we welcome you to become one, and you can find out more information about how to do that online at rff.org. Finally, after the event, we'll be sending out by email a quick survey. We always we think we do great events, but we always like to make them better, and we love your feedback on that, and so it'll just take you a minute if you don't mind responding to that afterward. And so with that, I'm going to turn it over to Daniel Ramey to dig into the details. Daniel.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'd like to start off today by saying thanks to Richard, who just left the room. I think he's going to come back. So Richard's been leading us for 7.5 years at RFF, and many of us on the staff have expressed our gratitude to him in a variety of forums, but I just wanted to do so publicly as well and say thank you, Richard, for your leadership and your mentorship, support of me and many other people here at RFF. So thank you very much. Okay, we're going to talk about the future of the global energy system today, and this is probably obvious to most of you in the room, but why do we care about the future of energy? We care for a lot of different reasons. We care because energy is fundamental to our way of life in the United States and ways of life all around the world. We care because access to energy is essential to provide a high quality of life, and we know that there are hundreds of millions of people around the world who lack access to modern energy services and reliable, affordable energy. We care about the future of energy because we care about climate change, and we care about other environmental problems that pose substantial risks, not just to the environment, but to human health and, indeed, like global civilization. So that's why we're talking about these things today. Before we get into the substance, I want to say thanks to everybody on the Global Energy Outlook team, the authors, myself, Yuqi, Richard, and Brian, but also our amazing communications colleagues, Christina Ross and Caroline, who put in lots of time to making the report look as good as it does. As Richard mentioned, there are a variety of energy outlooks that are available to decision makers and the general public, but they're really hard to put on an apples-to-apples basis and compare against one another so that you can actually understand the true range of perspectives about the future of energy that's out there. So what the Global Energy Outlook does is it standardizes across a variety of metrics. Some of these are simply the units in which outlooks report their findings. Units are reported in terms of tons of oil equivalent, quadrillion British thermal units, million barrels of oil equivalent, and much more. And that's actually the easy part to harmonize. There are other technical details that require probably hundreds or maybe thousands of lines of computer code to get this thing produced every year. So this year, we harmonize outlooks across 8 different organizations. We include BP Enerdata, which is an energy consultancy firm based in Europe, Equinor, ExxonMobil, the IEA, OPEC, Shell, and the EIA. In previous years, we've included additional outlooks. There are other outlooks that are out there as well, but most of them don't provide enough data and detail to allow us to actually produce a fully harmonized picture. And so we are getting, a good range of the outlooks that are out there, but it's not a completely comprehensive view. So diving straight into our key findings. The theme of the report this year is peaks or plateaus. And the reason we chose that theme is because there's been a lot of discussion in the media and even, you know, among members of Congress about, you know, when fossil fuels are going to peak. And that's an important question. But maybe an even more important question is not when the peak occurs, but what happens after the peak. Is there a peak followed by a plateau? Is there a peak followed by a plateau, or is there a peak followed by a decrease in fossil fuel consumption? And the implications for climate change and a variety of other outcomes really matter on what happens after the peak. So we'll talk about that today. We're going to talk a lot today about carbon dioxide removal technologies. And although they are very controversial for a variety of good reasons, they are deployed quickly and at scale in every scenario that limits climate change to 1.5 or 2 degrees Celsius by the year 2100 in the scenarios included here. So we'll talk about the implications for that. We're going to talk about the future of metals and critical minerals. What we find in the outlooks this year is that they are paying more and more attention to demand for these commodities, but there's a lot less attention paid to the supply of these commodities. And the detail on the supplies, where they're coming from, how much they're going to cost, the implications for local environments from these mining activities, those are explored in a lot less detail. So this is one area where there's a lot more work to do. We're going to talk about nuclear energy today. At COP28 in Dubai, nations pledged to triple their nuclear energy capacity by 2050, but that would require a reversal in trends in the United States, Europe, and Japan over the last several decades. And then we're going to talk about China. In China, the projections for future energy demand reflecting demographic and economic trends have been revised downward substantially in the last decade or so, and we'll talk about why that is. All right, I'm going to go into some kind of energy fuel-specific detail in just a moment, but before I do that, I want to give you a guide to the spaghetti lines that you're going to see all over the screen in a moment. We group scenarios into 3 different main categories: reference, evolving policies, and ambitious climate scenarios. Starting at the left side of this table, we have reference scenarios, which primarily include scenarios that are based on existing policies only. They assume that no major new policy efforts will be implemented on energy or climate change or energy efficiency or the like. Second, we have evolving policies scenarios. These are the scenarios that are based on existing and expected policies, based on announcements from governments or the expertise of the energy modeling teams that produce the outlooks. Those are in solid lines. There's also a dot dash format, the two dot dash lines at the bottom. These are scenarios that are explicitly based on pledges that nations have made as part of their nationally determined contribution as part of the Paris Agreement. So those dot dash lines you see, those are what governments say and have pledged to do under Paris, but they may not have implemented yet. In fact, they have not implemented yet. So these policies on the left side, these are based around kind of real world policies and real world announcements. The scenarios on the right side of the figure, the ambitious climate scenarios, these are not based on existing policies or announced policies. They're based on the end goal that the scenario has in mind. So they start with the goal of maintaining climate warming to 1.5 or 2 degrees Celsius, and then they figure out how the energy system might evolve to achieve those targets in the future. So that's kind of the key for what you'll see in a lot of these graphs over the next few minutes. All right, let's start with fossil fuels, coal, oil, and gas all put together at a global level. What you see here is that under most scenarios that include, you know, existing policies, fossil fuel demand grows relatively slowly or peaks by about 2030 and then, you know, roughly plateaus over the next few decades. What you see under the announced climate policies, such as policies announced as part of the Paris Agreement, as well as the ambitious climate scenarios, that's where you see a peak followed by, you know, a real decline, a meaningful decline. One thing that strikes us about this graph is that the range of projections for future fossil fuel demand is roughly equivalent to the amount of fossil fuel demand that we currently use at a global scale. And you're going to see that little nifty line move on several other charts in just a moment. One last thing that I'll point out on this figure is that despite a lot of conversation about the phase out of fossil fuels do not phase out under these ambitious climate scenarios. By 2050, there's still substantial fossil fuel use in the energy system. A lot of that is going into producing petrochemicals and used in the heavy industrial sector, but they're also used in a variety of applications and in many cases paired with carbon capture and sequestration. Along similar lines, and as I mentioned earlier, all of the ambitious climate scenarios that we look at include large-scale carbon capture and sequestration, and to be more precise, they include carbon dioxide removal, so removing CO2 from the atmosphere. There are a variety of ways to do that. Some of them are well-established and well-understood, like reforestation and afforestation, and then there are a variety of new technologies that are emerging that we'll have to watch and see. One of the implications of this slide, to me, is that as we scale up carbon dioxide removal technologies, we're going to need to scale up and improve monitoring, reporting, and verification requirements so that the carbon dioxide that people say they are removing are real and additional. We have all probably read news stories about forestry carbon offset projects that have not lived up to their stated goals. And so this is going to become a more and more important topic over time. Now I'm going to talk about each fossil fuel separately, coal, oil, and natural gas. When we look at the future of coal, you know, the large majority of scenarios project coal peaking and declining relatively quickly. The pace of decline varies a lot across scenarios, but with the exception of the US EIA, every projection we look at includes, you know, a pretty substantial decline in coal all around the world. When we look at, so the range of projections is also very wide for coal, roughly equivalent to all the coal demand that we use today. When we think about the future of oil, the story is a little bit more nuanced. Most of the scenarios that include, you know, existing and announced policies, they see, you know, a peak in the 2030s, but it's not a very sharp peak, right? It's roughly a plateau over the next several decades. If you look at the ambitious climate scenarios, of course, it's a very different story, and there's a substantial decline, but not a phase out of oil in the energy system. If you look under the hood of this global projection and you look at sort of regional trends, what you tend to see is that oil demand in the so-called West, right, the Europe and the Americas, declines under every scenario that we look at this year. All the growth is coming from emerging markets in Asia Pacific and Africa, as well as the Middle East. But of course, there's a wide range. Under ambitious climate scenarios, oil demand in those regions also declines. So again, the range of projections is roughly equivalent to the scale of oil demand today. Last, we have natural gas. And natural gas actually shows the most variation across scenarios and the widest range of potential futures under the scenarios that we looked at this year. Under reference and evolving policy scenarios, most of them envision, you know, slow growth or roughly flat growth over the projection period, whereas under ambitious climate scenarios, again, there's a decline. The fastest decline in natural gas demand, of course, occurs in the most ambitious climate scenarios. Let's dig a little bit more deeply into regional natural gas demand. I think we're going to talk about the pause on issuance of new permits for liquefied natural gas facilities in today's panel discussion, but to sort of tee that up a little bit, This graph shows regional projections for natural gas demand in the last 20 years or so, as well as in 2050. And what you see is on the left side of the figure, the ambitious climate scenarios envision natural gas consumption declining in every region around the world. If you look at policies based on existing policies and expected policies, that story is very different. Natural gas demand is roughly flat in the Americas and in Europe, but there's dramatic growth of natural gas demand in Asia Pacific, the Middle East, and Africa, and to a lesser extent, Latin America as well. Last, if we put all these fossil fuels together with renewables, you get this stacked bar chart, which shows fossil fuels at the bottom, wind and solar and nuclear and hydro up above them. And again, at the left side of the figure, you see historical energy usage by fuel. And at the right side, we see projections for 2050. The thing that stands out here to me more than anything else is that the overall rate of energy demand growth is actually pretty slow, even under a lot of the reference and evolving policy scenarios. So there's not a huge expectation of dramatically growing energy demand across the entire world. Instead, what we have is stagnating or declining energy demand in developed markets and growing energy demand in emerging markets. And in many scenarios, those roughly offset, so that the net growth in energy demand is pretty small. And under the ambitious climate scenarios, it's actually negative. This tells us that, you know, energy efficiency improvements are also an essential part of the story for any scenario where we achieve our long-term climate goals. So I've gone through a lot. I'm going to pause here and turn it over to my colleague Yuchi, who's going to talk about a few more findings, and then I'll come back and introduce our panel. Just press the green button.
Yeah. Thanks, Daniel. So the next few slides that we have here are focused on the electricity sector. And the slide here shows electricity demand in terawatt hours across our different scenarios. So with historical years on the left and then 2050 demand to the right. So overall demand grows pretty substantially in the electricity sector. So that's fueled by electrification in the buildings and transportation sectors. And digging a little deeper, we see that electricity demand from fossil fuel sources, so that's kind of at the bottom of the stacked bar chart, declines across scenarios, so about 58% in 2022, down to 42% or lower in 2050. At the same time, wind and solar account for half or more of the power generation in 2050. And you can see that here. And so while wind and solar grow rapidly under all scenarios, the data indicates that it's not inevitable that full decarbonization will happen. While coal and natural gas fall pretty significantly in the ambitious climate scenarios, they're still very much a part of the mix in reference and evolving policy scenarios. So this next slide that we have here, it digs a bit deeper into renewable electricity capacity. And what's shown here is an aggregate of wind, solar, as well as other renewable sources. At COP28, world leaders agreed to triple renewable energy capacity by 2030. But doing so would require pretty significant growth across all renewable technologies. And we've noted that 2030 target here on the chart with the red dot. And as you can see, only three ambitious climate scenarios actually achieve that goal. But as Daniel noted, ambitious climate scenarios are not based on existing or announced policies. So that highlights the need for additional policy action. One caveat is that historically, these models have underestimated the growth of both wind and solar, which means that reference and evolving policy scenarios may be somewhat understated compared to eventual 2030 reality. And this next slide looks at another commitment that was made at COP, which Daniel alluded to, which was the tripling of renewable energy capacity by 2050. As you can see with the historical data here on the left side of this graph, renewable capacity has been flat or has grown only modestly since the 1990s. And with the 2050 target that we've again denoted here with the red dot, this time on the right side of the graph, we see that only two scenarios, both from EnerData, actually reach this goal. In fact, the range of projections for 2050 spans roughly 800 gigawatts, which is nearly twice the current 2022 installed capacity. And so reaching this target would require a reversal of the recent growth trends, especially in developed nations, and would require growth that we haven't seen since the 1980s. Next, we have two slides that are on topics that we explore in a lot more detail in our report, but which we'll just briefly mention here. So first is a deep dive into critical minerals, which are increasingly more important as energy technologies such as wind, solar, and battery storage grow. And so on this chart, we show growth in that demand on a log scale, so with 2022 as the reference year for three key minerals. We have vanadium, which is used in specialized steel making, gallium, which is used in semiconductors and electronics, and lithium, which we use in electric vehicles as well as battery storage. And so there's massive growth in demand for these minerals, but it's worth noting that they start from a fairly small base in the year 2022. And there's also a few additional things to consider. So while these outlooks are providing data, demand data, none of them have really in-depth analysis for costs or supply. And additionally, as demand rises, it's also important to note the significant human rights issues and geopolitical questions that surround these minerals. And those uncertainties need to be addressed in the coming decade. And finally, the second topic that we're looking at here is on China's projections in the face of economic uncertainty. So on this slide, we have charts that outline both coal demand as well as renewable demand. And what we've done here is we've taken the stated policy scenarios from EIA and IEA for their most recent 2023 outlooks, and those are denoted here in the solid lines. And then we compare them against the equivalent scenarios from 10 years ago, and those are denoted by the dashed lines. So if we start with coal on the left, we see that over the past two decades, coal demand has grown pretty dramatically in China. And this continued growth was reflected in the 2013 outlooks, but in the most recent outlooks, both IEA and EIA are projecting a peaking and then a declining of coal by 2030. And so while that decline is driven partially by new policies, including a push towards cleaner energy sources, it's also due to a slowing economy caused mostly by weaknesses in the real estate sector, as well as an overall declining population. And on the right side, we have a chart that shows renewables, which tell a pretty different story. So for renewables, those have been revised upwards since 2013. And that's been driven by massive growth in both solar and wind. And this growth is being supported a lot by subsidies as well as government policies. And the country is actually projected to more than double its stated 2030 goals. So all of this data and more is available on our website at rff.org/geo. There you'll find harmonized data from all sources that we've talked about here, but also previous outlooks that date back to 2016, and historical data as well. And on the website, you're able to sort of visualize, sort, or download any of this data and, you know, manipulate it yourself. If you have any questions, comments, or suggestions, feel free to reach out to me or Daniel. Our emails are here on this slide. And with that, I'll turn it back to Daniel, who will close this out and introduce the panel.
Thanks, Eugene. All right. So I'm so pleased to introduce our panelists and our moderator today. I'll invite them to come to the stage as I introduce them. Come on up, everybody. I'll talk about you as you're, when you can't look at me. So we always have great panelists for these discussions, and this year is no exception. We're thrilled that Gloria Gonzalez is going to be moderating our discussion. She's the deputy energy editor at Politico Pro. Gloria has two decades of experience writing, reporting, and editing stories on energy and other topics. And we're just thrilled that she could join us. Next to Gloria is Adam Siminski. Adam is a senior advisor to the King Abdullah Petroleum Studies and Research Center at Riyadh, also known as CAPSARC. Before his time at CAPSARC, Adam was the James R. Schlesinger Chair for Energy and Geopolitics at the Center for Strategic and International Studies. He was also the administrator of the U.S. Energy Information Administration and the Senior Director for Energy and Environment on the staff of the United States National Security Council. Before that, Adam worked at Deutsche Bank and other firms on Wall Street and wanted me to tell everybody that he has never been indicted of anything. I asked him about statutes of limitations, and he didn't respond to that. Next to Adam is Melissa Lott. Melissa is a professor at Columbia University's Climate School and the former director of research on at the Center on Global Energy Policy at Columbia. Among the many hats that she wears, Dr. Lott serves on the UN Council of Engineers for the Energy Transition, and she's a member of the World Economic Forum's Global Future Council on the Future of Economics of Equitable Transition. Last but not least, we have Kenneth Lay. Kenneth is a senior managing director at Rock Creek Group. We're particularly grateful for Ken because he's stepping in for his colleague, Afsane Beschloss, who was not able to make it due to a family issue. Rock Creek is a global investment firm focused on integrating balanced teams and sustainability into investing to generate long-term value. Formerly, Kenneth was the treasurer of the World Bank, where he oversaw more than $100 billion in investments and introduced green bonds and catastrophe bonds to further the institution's climate change mitigation efforts. With that, I will turn it over to Gloria and look forward to her questions, and of course, we'll have questions from you soon. Thank you.
Absolutely. Well, first of all, thank you all for attending. It's a nice crowd. Think about your questions that you might have for the panelists. I'll sort of kick things off as we go along here, but just a few opening thoughts from me. I was lucky enough to have a chance to look at the draft findings of the report, and so much has happened in the last 4 or 5 months since COP. Obviously, you might have heard there's been a ban on LNG, a pause on LNG, excuse me, pause on LNG imports, exports. And so there's also been use related to hydrogen hubs as well. So those are some of the technologies that the Biden administration is supporting through multiple areas of funding. And we'll get into some of the technologies in the discussion, but I couldn't help but think about the COP discussions, the lead up to COP. And one of the things that was very relevant in the discussion is there was a lot of talk of what language would come out of the COP negotiations. There was talk about whether or not we could see language related to a phase out of fossil fuels. That obviously was not the ultimate language that emerged from the discussions, but there was language about transitioning away from fossil fuels, and that in itself was historic, even if it didn't go as far as some folks think it should go. So maybe we could just kind of start there in terms of the overall report findings, very clear about what the impact of not transitioning away from fossil fuels will be. Maybe Adam, I'll just start with you. If you could just kind of go, give me your thoughts about what that means. Can we get to our climate goals without transitioning away from fossil fuels?
Thank you, Gloria. Let me just mention that the idea of phasing out fossil fuels seems to me to be putting the problem in the wrong way. The problem is not the fuel, the problem is greenhouse gas emissions. And that's, from my standpoint, that's what we need to be working on. One of the easiest ways to deal with emissions, greenhouse gas emissions, would be controlling methane, and that did come out of COP28. Right. A number of countries pledged to reduce methane emissions, and I see that as a very important outcome and should be given the highest priority because it could have a lot of impact even in the near term. Back to the idea of phasing out fossil fuels. Look, there are three kind of general classes of problems with the idea of trying to put the burden on hydrocarbons and stopping their use. One is there are a lot of applications that are very hard to abate, extremely expensive. Airlines is one, cement manufacturing, metal smelting, heavy duty transportation is, you know, another. Second class of problems is one involving equity. I noticed when I came in that there's a really nice report from Resources for the Future on the equity and justice issues associated with environmental issues. And I think that you could generalize on that and say that there's climate equity and justice issues. Everybody knows there's more than 2 billion women and children that don't have clean cooking fuels. There's 1 billion people that don't have electricity. How we're going to manage that problem is like a really interesting one from my standpoint. And the third issue is kind of the existing infrastructure question. And you know, how we make the transition to all electricity, which is discussed in the RFF report, by the way, is a tricky one. This is a complex problem. It's not going to be solved with really easy solutions. I think we're summing up. You know, prior energy transitions required a lot of technology and economic driving. This one we're trying to do with policy, and that makes it a little bit different. And how we manage the north-south issues and these equity justice issues is another one. The third factor that I think, again, that we want to just keep in mind is that there might be better ways to do a lot of these things, and we need to get everybody working together to deal with these issues. I think that it's not going to do what we want to do if we try to pick our favorite things. You know, I like solar, I like nuclear, I like carbon capture and storage. I think we need all of those, right? Everything working together to manage the size of the problem that we have. And I want to come back, but not now, and talk a little bit about what I think is really great about the RFF study and what I'd like to see in the future.
Yeah, absolutely. I want to follow up on the justice question, because that is something with regard to some of the particular technologies that some folks have some issues with, but wanted to give our other panelists a chance to weigh in on that overall question. You know, can we reach these climate goals without phasing out fossil fuels?
Ken, you want to go first?
I think that we've been making the effort in different settings for quite some time. And I think we understand what a lot of the impediments are to moving quickly in this way. And so when Adam mentioned that he's thinking about this all of the above approach to this, I couldn't agree more. I think the we also, and to get into the justice issues, I mean, every time this issue comes up in various settings, you have the impact on local communities of this transition, which immediately creates serious problems. And I think there's also, to my mind, we haven't really effectively, I think, costed out what is the real underlying cost of a lot of this. As it does impact the communities and other aspects of the ecosystem in which we're operating. And so then that leads to a push in certain directions. And then only later do people realize, oh, I'm that transition to wind or solar, that has caused other problems and that may not have been taken fully into account. So I think there's a lot more room to both get, I think some of the work that's getting done here is very helpful in this, to get a real assessment of the costs and benefits of the different approaches, and then have a communication effort that is sufficient to really bring popular support for some of these tough decisions. In the situations I've been seeing, There's a lot of discussion in the academic community and in the business community, but there is not a whole lot of communication with the people on the ground whose daily lives are going to be affected by the changes. And only when the changes happen do they stand up and say, wait a minute, I hadn't seen that coming. And then that causes a lot of I think a lot of additional impediments to making things move forward.
I mean, at a high level, when we look across all these scenarios, so I'm not disagreeing with y'all's points, I'm focusing in on a different piece of the question, I think, which is, in all scenarios where we hit our climate targets, and that's not just net zero by a certain date, it's actually caring about the path to net zero, we will use less fossil fuels. I'm generalizing across several fuels with that, in that future when we've hit net zero. We will use less. It will be a different balance of things in different parts of the world, where we have different resource availability, where we have different priorities we have set with our policies, where we have different types of ability to consider certain security concerns, is just one example. But we will use less if we're going to hit those targets. And so how quickly we use less and what places in the world will actually use more, because there are many places in the world that use essentially none today. Mm-hmm. And there's not a future that we think is reasonable in which we wouldn't see those numbers go up. But the future is, if we're going to hit our climate targets, if we're going to be roughly aligned with Paris, somewhere in that 1.5 to 2 degrees, we will use less. And we know that. Will we use zero? I have not seen yet, and if you have one, I want to see it, a credible pathway where we use no fossil fuels? And this is a discussion I get with my students all the time. Is it absolute zero or net zero? Practically speaking, if we care about affordability, reliability, and cleanness across multi dimensions, we still end up using fossil fuels even beyond the really trickiest places to abate it, where we're not using those fossil fuels to necessarily burn them, we're using them as feedstocks and chemical reactions and all of that. But there are some places where, who's been to Iceland? If not, it's gorgeous, you should consider it. If I'm in Reykjavik, great, I've got a lot of geothermal, that's gonna keep me warm right. in the winter, that's fantastic. If I'm in the eastern and western fjords, it is not practical to get a massive grid out to me if I want to hear about affordability. I may keep using diesel. And that may make sense, and I may offset it. I think this is why we see a lot of the carbon dioxide removal comments that you made. We use them in all scenarios. That's the finding, right? Mm-hmm. That both shows how slow we have been to respond to the changing climate and to get emissions down, so how small we have in terms of space on cumulative emissions. But it also shows the practicality of a pathway forward. So if I want to keep the cost low, I'm going to still have some emissions that then I need to get rid of in a real sense, in a real way.
Indeed.
Well, let me just jump in and,
and
debate a bit.
I'm excited. I'm excited. Let's do it. Let's do it.
So I think it's certainly possible. One of the many of the scenarios in this study, in fact, that was the whole point of looking at it, show a decline in the use of coal and oil. Maybe natural gas might go up. I mean, it's like that kind of thing. I just would caution from my long career as being, I was supposedly noted as one of the best forecasters on Wall Street. And I would say two things about that. You know, I got lucky, and two, just try not to be wrong right away, but you're gonna be wrong. Yeah. And if you talk about the year 2050 or 2100, the chances of something going wrong in your forecast are high. So what I would say is that policymakers ought to consider some of the reference case scenarios. EnerData's base case, EIA's reference case, OPEC's base case, and Exxon's. Mm-hmm. Because what they're showing there is what we have seen so far, that consumers don't easily give up any of the fuels. That we don't get right. transitions. We didn't transition from coal to oil and gas. We actually are using more coal now than we ever have. So what we do is we use a different fuel, a better fuel, a cheaper fuel, a more climate sensitive fuel. And so we ought to from a policy standpoint, have a way to robustly address the possibility that hydrocarbons are going to continue to be burned, and we're going to have to recycle, reuse, better efficiency, and then ultimately remove. And one of the wonderful things about the RFF report is that it looks at the need for carbon capture and storage and utilization. As a realistic policy goal, and says that, you know, like, we'll do it. It's not like
agreeing
it's
so far,
not
so I'm
disagreeing
waiting.
With
I'm
you.
Waiting for it, yeah.
It's just basically saying we have to be prepared for different scenarios.
Oh, absolutely. So a key difference, and oh man, when I worked at the International Energy Agency, the IEA, not EIA, though I was there too. The forecast for scenario thing is so important. And so in the comments I made, hopefully I was very intentional about saying, if we want to achieve these things, then there's stuff we have to do. We are not on track to achieve those things at all.
Right.
We are not anywhere close to it. So back to the peak versus plateau, we have not bent this curve. We're using more of all the fuels, mostly. We're using more of all of them because our history in energy is one of additions, not substitutions. Right. We're still using the same amount of wood and like rough crude biomass that we used in the 1800s. We just have added things on top of the stack. But that's where what we're trying to do, we haven't done it yet, trying to do is fundamentally different. If we are gonna bring emissions down, we have to not only meet energy demand needs, but do it in a way where we are substituting fuels and bringing it down. So this isn't a forecast, it's a discussion of scenarios. Forecasting, well, yeah, I would actually be projecting in much shorter periods of time because man, uncertainty just goes like this as I go further, hedging my bets. But also, you know, that's not the question I'm going for. I'm saying, if we want to achieve something, what do we have to do? And once we agree on the degree of effort, which I think we all agree, you want to hit net zero, you want to mitigate climate change, speed, scale are both massive. We have to move fast and we have to move huge. If we're going to do that, we need to get our eyes around the practical things. And that's what you see in all these scenarios. There are practical things we have to put in place, not just technical barriers we have to overcome as we scale up technologies that we haven't done at the scale we want to use them, whether it's carbon capture, the utilization pieces of it, all the climate and carbon tech stuff that we have to do, but also the non-technical pieces. We have to figure out how to build stuff quickly, because the reality is any scenario that is looking at getting to net zero is not, I wish it was, but it's not a utopia where we're just like, oh, we don't have to do much to get there. We just have to stop doing these things. It's like, no, we have to build a ton of stuff very quickly, even in countries that have tons of infrastructure. And in the countries that don't have infrastructure, we also, in the back of these scenarios, we have to think about getting everyone onto the system. And that is, you know, kind of a baseline assumption that we make in different scenarios that we project, which is that we're not going to keep the status quo when it comes to energy use, when we're talking about a global picture. A lot of countries will very much change. So I think we're agreeing on a lot of this, actually. We just are hyping on the scenario versus forecast. I'm not forecasting it's going to happen. Talking about what needs to happen if we want to move forward.
Well, let's see about that, if that's the issue. Let's talk more about carbon capture. Obviously, the report highlights how important it will be to meet these scenarios, but it also references the fact that carbon capture is quite controversial. A lot of people in the environmental and environmental justice communities in particular have problems with carbon capture, arguments that it extends the life of fossil fuels, that it's an injustice issue for people who are in the communities where these polluting infrastructure is located. So how do you deal and address those particular challenges, scale up the technology while actually addressing some of those concerns?
I have many thoughts, but I just spoke. Anybody want
to? On this issue, and I'm coming at this having just seen in the state of Wyoming the decision that Rocky Mountain Power has made to go forward with carbon capture, utilization, and storage in one of the two big coal-fired plants there. It has taken forever to get moved to that point. And it's a combination. It's a combination of political factors, the regulatory structure that's regulating public utilities and the rate determinations. There's a lot of those things which have a very tangible effect in slowing this entire process. I would make the point on the small modular nuclear. Mm-hmm. It takes people forever to get permits to move forward with what most people are saying are, actually pretty well-established designs. We're finally seeing in that same setting, one, we've got Bill Gates and Warren Buffett, as I'm sure many of you know, moving forward with their TerraPower project to replace one of the coal-fired plants in the state. Everybody understands this is going to be good for the local community. There's a whole transition for the workers, and which gets to this justice issue, but it is taking forever to move this at a time when I think the sense of urgency that we've all been feeling on this issue has risen. So I think there are some really fundamental things that are going to have to get tackled, and that's in a developed country setting. If we move to the emerging markets, where the direction that you can see is that these poor countries, as the energy access need becomes more intense, we really have got to have a roadmap that can help that happen without going and building a lot more coal-fired plants, to pick an example. Hmm. But I think these are tough challenges that, We can know where we need to go, but we have got to figure out how to get the system mm-hmm. aligned.
Mm-hmm. I mean, from an equity and justice standpoint, first off, equity, justice, two different things, or very related, but two different things. And within it, we focus often on like mitigating risks and downsides, but there's also the equally important discussion about who gets opportunities in this transition, who has access to those opportunities. And anyone who works on Justice 40 or equivalent examples around the world has said, what does it mean? What are the benefits we count? What communities are we targeting in terms of providing those opportunities? Like, there's an entire discussion within that. But two things. When we talk about getting big stuff done quickly, and the first part of that was intentional because it's actually a book that if you haven't read it is fantastic, and it talks about how do we actually build mega projects? How do we get big stuff done? Mm-hmm. And within that, how do we engage with communities to not just address concerns, step back a second, understand concerns, which come in a lot of different forms, some of which may be obvious to us because of our own life experiences and our own priorities, but other ones, absolutely not, because we haven't lived in those places. We haven't experienced life in those places. And we just have different priorities that we pick in our own personal lives. So within that, how do we design systems that work for communities? Because the pathways forward when it comes to these mega projects, whether you read the book I mentioned or another one called The Speed of Trust, I don't know if anyone's explored that here, but it says, you know, these projects move at the speed of trust when we're trying to move mountains, as it were, move huge projects or huge numbers of smaller projects. Mm-hmm. And so when we talk about carbon capture, or I'll say the closely related carbon dioxide removal, so whether we're capturing those emissions out of smokestack after we've burned something somewhere, mm-hmm. or we are actually filtering out the air, there's a lot of questions about, especially with the second one, who gets those opportunities. So I'll give one quick example, which is in my work with the United Nations, but also this came up at COP, after the last COP, so not the one we just had, but the year before that, was, okay, so great, we're now gonna pay people to remove carbon or to rebuild the ecosystem they destroyed. Well, I never destroyed my ecosystem, so where do I get credit? Where do I get credit for that? Or are we actually creating up a system that incentivizes me to do bad and then do good because I'll get paid for it on both sides of that equation? So how do we have the incentives and make sure they're right? It's a really good one. But we haven't written the playbook for CCUS. We haven't written the playbook for CDR, and we need to do that, and we need to do it quickly. Right. If, again, we want to achieve a goal of mitigating climate change in line with roughly what we said we would have ambition for in the Paris Climate Agreement.
The IRA and infrastructure legislation in the United States is making some progress towards finding ways to do demonstration and pilot projects, I think, that are going to be desperately needed in a lot of different areas. And this is one of the areas where financing from the financial community is going to be critical, and finding ways under ESG, environment, social, and government issues to make all of the options for managing greenhouse gas emissions kind of qualify in some way as ESG friendly would be really important. I have a big problem, Gloria, with the idea that you shouldn't like CCUS because it would enable the continuing use of fossil fuels. I want to go back to what I said at the beginning. The problem is not the fuel. The problem is the emissions. If you can deal with the emissions, then you're on your way.
What if you can't deal with the emissions?
Well, we know we can. It's just expensive. So now we now have to get the cost down. So all you have to do, go back and look at the literature in 1990, or 1980. Renewables were too expensive, and we were never going to have a lot of renewables because the cost for solar panels was too high and the cost for wind was too high. We've driven those costs down. Now what we need is government policies all around the world to drive the cost down of other technologies that will manage carbon emissions. Direct air capture being one of those. When I first started looking at direct air capture, it was more than $1,000 a ton to do it. Mm-hmm. Then it came down to $500. Now it's down to $200. If you could get direct air capture down to $100 a ton, I think you could start to do it everywhere, and you could put direct air capture in the places where you have the storage capability. So then you don't have to move stuff around, which is costly. So I'm going to come back to it. I want to be an optimist about this. I started off my career as an engineer, and I think that there are engineering solutions to a lot of these problems, and we just have to give technology and economics the opportunity to address them.
I'm going to say one quick comment because Daniel's not going to give himself a shout out, so I'll do it anyway. So Daniel and then my colleague at Columbia, Noah Kaufman, and another one of my colleagues at Notre Dame, so Emily Grubert and others, are involved in a project that looks at what does this transition look like in fossil fuel communities.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And you're focusing mostly on the U.S. within all these studies, right?
Right.
For now, for the moment. But within this, there's an interesting conversation around equity, which is, we have been the backbone of supplying all the things the economy needs to date. We deserve to be a part of the future. What is our role? Mm-hmm. You know, and this has come up in the United Auto Workers discussions around transitions to electric vehicles. Like, this is a common theme, mm-hmm. and it's a legitimate set of questions that we really need to consider. A parallel one is in developing and emerging economies. You got to emit. Now I'm going to do it. How am I going to do that? How am I going to be allowed to do that? And what technologies will I have access to? But bottom line from all these scenarios, my takeaway, this entire thing, if again, we're going to decarbonize, or if we're just going to build the energy system of the future, is that affordable, reliable, and clean to whatever degree you're going to achieve in your scenario, because clean power is way cheaper than it used to be, so we will see some of that no matter what, is that it is a team sport. And we need a lot of different players on the field. The ones that we pick depends on who we are, as in, is it my community? I may like or dislike something. Globally, we can talk about those mixes, but how does it actually play on a local level is a really interesting set of questions.
And one of the things that's interesting to me is related to hydrogen. The Biden administration has been trying to address the cost problem, as you've mentioned, with hydrogen. Also, the issue of how do you revitalize these communities that have been relying on fossil fuels, locating some of the hubs there. So what is the role of hydrogen, and how do you get over some of those challenges related to that technology? Or should you?
I can talk about hydrogen for however much time we have left. But, I'm not going to quote the colors of the rainbow, though. For those who know Julia Friedman, we did break into song on a podcast episode we did about the hydrogen rainbow. We'll leave the colors out of it for a minute. When it comes to hydrogen, it is a Swiss Army knife. It's not going to be great in every situation, but dang, you're glad to have it in a lot of them. It seems like there's a lot of places where hydrogen can deploy. We get into these conversations about how hydrogen can be everywhere doing all the things. I mean, I guess could be. I'm an engineer. I can tell you how it could work. But practically speaking, it probably makes a lot of sense in industry. It probably makes a decent amount of sense, at least as an energy storage vehicle within power generation. In some parts of transport, maybe, especially if we take those H's and hook them onto other things and use them as different fuels, because those molecules are valuable. In home heating, I can tell you how that could work. Does it make sense given other options? In most cases, probably not. There's always a niche case where it does. But hydrogen is one of those things that if we're going to get our arms around it, we have to think about the climate impacts, we have to think about the cost economics, and we have to think about, back to the team sport, what positions or position does it need to play to make the whole team stronger? Hydrogen on its own is like everything else. It's not a silver bullet that fixes this entire thing. It's just not. But it does make sense in a lot of places. And so those places will use it.
I'm just curious, what do you think is the currently the single biggest impediment to seeing an acceleration of the work on hydrogen?
So I think it's a combination of, so cost, well, I'm going to back up. Cost. We don't have definitions, actually, so this gets really tricky. Is it, I said I wasn't going to do colors. Is it green? Is it blue? What's clean? Oh, well, I don't know. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So blue hydrogen being, okay, we use natural gas and then we captured a lot of it.
Yeah. So Melissa, this is where I really want to agree with you.
Oh, I hate the colors.
You.
Yeah.
That's a tense question. Melissa, what she said, she started off saying, let's not talk about the colors of hydrogen. Right? Okay. How can you do that as an engineer? Yeah, yeah. Right? How do you do that instead of an artist knowing about colors?
But it's what
the answer
saying.
Is measurement, reporting, and verification.
Sure.
So MRV is a huge issue. In fact, there was a disappointment that they didn't make more progress at COP28 on MRV issues. If you can say what the greenhouse gas footprint is of the various technologies that we are driving, hydrogen being one of them, then you will make. Then you don't have to talk about the color. What you want to do is try to emphasize the kind of solution that has the lowest impact on either creating greenhouse gases or the highest one on getting rid of them.
Yeah, but on the cost thing, we're just not there yet when it comes to getting to, I'm going to say net zero hydrogen, no color in there, net zero hydrogen. I mean, even when it comes to green, so produce renewable electricity, we still haven't figured that one out. Because, like, do I have to time match my electron supply to what degree? Is hourly 15 minutes? Good night. So I agree with you on this one. The other thing is we are going to try to use hydrogen in a lot more places than we have before. We have to, like, do that, learn from it, do it better, learn from it, do it better. The last thing I'll say is around our infrastructure. I mean, just because we have a pipeline, it is not suited for hydrogen today. It may be, it's not cast iron, just forget about it. It may be suited for a blending of hydrogen and with natural gas. So, but we don't have a hydrogen network that is extensive all over, you know, the country or all over different regions, not the whole world, like we do for natural gas. And that is a big impediment. So we talk about shipping it around as ammonia because we know what to do with ammonia. We've got a lot of experience with ammonia. Maybe that makes sense in a lot of applications. Like, I used to live in Japan. Man, hydrogen is a different discussion in Japan than when I'm back in my home state of Texas. It's like an import versus export conversation, these types of things. But again, it's a player on the field. It's not the only player. It's a member of the team.
Indeed. You mentioned something I wanted to get back to, methane. Obviously, we're seeing a lot of regulatory action from the EPA on the methane front. There's going to be a methane fee. What are your thoughts about those efforts, regulatory efforts specific to methane, but also regulatory efforts more generally regarding
Broadly, this brings us right back to the measurement, reporting, and verification issues. There are now satellites that can identify methane emissions and do a pretty good job at it. So there's not going to be any place to hide, right? Like, you're going to be able to identify where leaks are coming from and who's responsible for them, largely. And it'll be supplemented by, you know, aircraft and drones and other ways of measuring, but the satellites will be able to do a lot. And I understand that there's actually now a lot of work going on identifying CO2 emissions by satellite, right? And so once we know where it's coming from, then you can begin to formulate the policies to deal with it. Coming back to methane, CAPSARC got involved in doing a satellite survey with KROS of Saudi Arabia, and what they discovered was the methane emissions from energy-related activities were actually lower than the numbers that everybody had been using, and that's pretty good news. They also are finding that methane emissions from municipal waste dumps is an issue, and that's true all over the world. So it's again one of those things that I think people kind of lose sight of. How do you, you know, it's one of the many things that we have to tackle at the same time if we're going to deal with the issue. But methane is one of the critical issues, hydrogen being another. And I would just say, when I say technology, I mean it broadly. One of the really good ways to deal with methane emissions and carbon dioxide emissions is forestry, so particularly carbon dioxide, forestry, and nature-based solutions, ocean, grasses, seaweed, and things like mangrove restorations. So they're doing a lot of that in the Middle East, but it's also possible to do mangrove restorations in places like Florida, Louisiana, Texas, and so on. And I think that it's going to be important, again, to do as many things as you can at the same time.
Fine. We can't keep throwing away methane as if it's free or at least extremely cheap. It's like, it's a missed opportunity because I can't sell it. No. Well, it's way more than that. And you weren't saying that, to be clear. I'm talking about other conversations. I wish I could sell that. Wouldn't it be great if I had pipeline capacity and I could put it into that pipeline and actually sell it to someone instead of flaring it off or something like that? Wouldn't I like to reduce leakage? Because then I would, again, have more to put into a market. Absolutely. But beyond that, it's acknowledging that it is absolutely not free to chuck methane out there, and it hurts us in the short term. And eliminating leakage, eliminating flaring when possible, like, that's win-win-wins. And so how do we encourage it? How do we make sure that not just in the U.S. and not just amongst those countries who were in the commitment that came out of COP, but also within that subset that don't have regulations around this really or cost recovery methods, how do you make sure that we're incentivizing it so it happens fast? Because it's a win we can get very quickly. It's not something that, again, we got to prove, demo a big plant, you know, and over the next couple decades we'll do a lot. It's stuff we can do today in the next few years to at least start taking chunks off of that issue.
Indeed.
And it's a big one.
You know, we've been talking a lot about policy, but obviously politics comes into play here. There's a big election coming up, and not just in the United States, you know, in other countries as well. How does that play into all this, the potential change in administration? How could that change the path that the U.S. and other countries are currently on?
A baseline with a number before, more than half the global population is going through a major election this year.
Yeah,
I think it's 54 or 57%. Someone fact check me, but it's over 50. So we're sitting here in DC. We obviously have one on our mind, but I mean also states and other ones. But more than half the global population is going through this. So that's a number to baseline it. What do you guys think?
I try to stay away from forecasting oil prices and elections, but the elections matter in the short run, but I think that we're talking about a problem that we're trying to deal with in 2050 and beyond. And so the election coming up in November here in the United States is important, but ultimately, regardless of the administration that's in the Oval Office, I think, or Congress, we'll have to be dealing with greenhouse gas emission management because it's critical and it's necessary, and that's basically the science of it. So the politics ultimately will follow.
I think I'm going to disagree slightly, only on a little okay. piece of it, though. Leadership matters. Like, I do all my techno-economic optimized models. Sorry, I'm making fun of myself when I say that. I am an energy systems modeler. I create these scenarios that RFF has, like, gone through. And I'm humble in it in the sense of the technologies I can make work, the economics. I know what my hits need to be, at least. I know how far you need to get the cost down before you see it deploy in a realistic situation. But leadership matters in terms of elevating, at a minimum, solving the non-technical barriers and putting money behind solving the remaining technical barriers to getting all the way to net zero. So again, if the scenario we're trying to make reality is to get to net zero along a pathway that is 1.5 to 2 degrees, if that is our goal, leadership matters a lot because there's a bunch of different things we can focus on at any given time, and elevating this to be the issue we're gonna go after. I mean, I worked Obama first term here in DC when it was the cap and trade and then healthcare policy. There's a lot of different priorities we're trying to balance at any given time, and having people in positions that elevate this do impact the likelihood of going down that path. And how much we have in the near or long term do matter when it comes to the assumptions. Also within that, they affect the geopolitics of this entire thing. And if one thing comes out of this when it comes to critical materials and supply chains that we need to make this reality, like the wind turbine does not appear. It's got tons of steps behind it. We all know this. But those pieces come from lots of different places in the world. But for individual components and individual raw materials, they only come from a few. It's very different. So Adam's going to know this number better than me. When you talk about top three oil producers in the country, it's under 50% of total global supply that they put. I think it's in the 40s, though, right? For the top three countries, it's in that ballpark. I'm in the ballpark.
Right.
But when you talk about different types of critical minerals, you could see the top three countries supplying 90%.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, these are very different futures when you talk about one or two geopolitical shifts where, you know, Gloria, I liked you last week, but this week we're just not talking and you're not gonna get any of what I want. I'm putting it over here. Those are very different paradigms. And so intentional moves to shift that paradigm if we are gonna be accelerating the transition matter a lot. And they're one of the non-technical considerations in all this, so.
Yeah. We're gonna open it up for questions in a few minutes, but I just wanna follow up on that because the role of China in particular is obviously so important. The U.S. and China did come to some agreement with regard to particular methane, addressing methane, but did it go as far as it needs to, and what is the next step? And when you have a country that controls most of the supply chain for renewable energy in particular, how do you address those issues of constraint?
I'm looking at you with your background, if you want to comment first. I have thoughts on all these things.
The U.S.-China politics, I am not going to try to get into that. What does seem important to me is that, and this came out in the report that we're discussing here, but I think we are seeing, because we're seeing, I don't know, some people used to call it the middle-income trap, but you've had a country that's been growing like this. Now it's plateaued and the population is actually declining, and I think that changes the dynamic of a lot of this. And I also think that some of the trade policy changes to try to
I think, to reduce the dependency of these industries, the supply chains you're talking about, on that source. But I, you know, where this goes, very hard to say.
Indeed. I saw a hand right behind Daniel. Could you, is there a microphone?
So while we're getting a microphone over there, one of the things that Daniel and Resources of the Future have been doing in these studies is harmonizing the broad range of scenarios that come out. There are things like, what's the choice of reporting Daniel mentioned? Is it BTUs or is it millions of tons and that kind of thing? There's even issues associated with, you know, how do you measure liquids? Do you include natural gas liquids along with the oil and how you do that? It's really important if you're going to be able to compare these things. And so I want to compliment RFF on that. One quick thing, since Ken mentioned population, I noticed that that there's a wide range of assumptions about how much primary energy is going to be used in 2050, but it's a really narrow band of what population is going to be in 2050. And I had lunch yesterday with a colleague who said that the drop in birth rates in Korea had really surprised her. And I think that that's something that we might want to think about, what the population numbers are. The other thing that I noticed is that there's a pretty close assumption about what GDP will be in the year 2050. And, you know, it's about twice what it is now. And, you know, it seems to me that it might make sense for somebody to look at what happens if population is lower, what happens if GDP is higher or lower, as a way of bracketing some of these studies. So.
Hi, Alan Loeb, Washington attorney. So I'm going to ask my question mostly directed to Adam, and that is, the characterization was made that when you add a technology, you don't displace the previous technology, it simply adds to the supply. And I think that that works if you're talking about staying within the same energy paradigm.
Right.
And so you have incremental change and sources are additive and they compete economically. But that's not historically very accurate because, you know, you have to account for the fact that when oil was drilled in 1859 in Titusville, it didn't add to whale oil, it displaced whale oil. And when electric lighting displaced, you know, kerosene, beginning in the 1880s, 1890s, it displaced kerosene for lighting. And the same is true of automobiles. You didn't see an increase in horse-drawn carriages or personal vehicles when you had the introduction of internal combustion automobiles. So what you're essentially saying is we are going to stay, it's sort of a self-fulfilling prophecy, because you're characterizing, you know, staying within the same paradigm when what is needed is actually to jump out of that paradigm. And if you make it seem normalized, then what you're doing is you're actually making people comfortable with the idea that we'll just have incremental change. But actually, you know, there are things that have happened by regulation. We got the lead out of gasoline. Yeah. We got CFCs out. So I think you need to broaden your scope.
Kind of heard a question in there, kind of.
So just very quickly, I'm going to concede the point on whale oil. there's a guy that's actually written a study. If you give me your email address, I'll send it to you. Whale oil consumption actually did go up after oil was found in Pennsylvania for a period of time until we stopped, until we ran out of whales, basically. So the kerosene is I wouldn't use that as an example. We definitely use less kerosene in lamps, but we're using an enormous amount of kerosene in jet airliners. That's what they run on, jet kerosene. And so coming back, we can probably find one or two instances where something was really not as useful and we substituted rather than added. But generally speaking, we've been adding. Oil consumption is at an all-time high. Natural gas consumption is at an all-time high. Coal consumption. And one of the things about the study, Daniel, and maybe you did it in prior years, you looked a lot at China, but I think you need to look at India. Coal consumption in India is huge, and it looks like it's growing. The population in India is growing. China's is going down. That's one of these population issues that I think that we're going to go. So I'd come back. Let me agree with you that I think that if we're going to solve this problem, we really do need some new paradigms. And I think that what we need to do is we need to get everybody, every country needs to be able to address greenhouse gas management in the way that's best for them, gets the job done. And I think that where the role the United States clearly is playing and doing a good job at it is, I think, fostering these demonstration and pilot projects. No good deed goes unpunished. There are a lot of countries. There's one African country that's complaining bitterly that they thought they were going to have a hydrogen project, and it's now been the capital has come to the United States rather than the African country.
Okay, I saw the hand to the left first. Could you please state your name and affiliation and question, please?
Oh, my name is Angel Fang. I work for Opto Capital Group. We specialize in global macro investment. Mm-hmm. My question is, what's the impact of the AI electricity demand on the overall global energy demand and the energy mix, supply mix? Thank you.
So a couple different things I'll just say at a high level, counterintuitive findings, and Daniel's just going to jump up and down if he finds anything else because I want to know, and all of y'all who are on the team. The more you electrify, the less electricity you need going to net zero. What I mean by that is if I move to net zero, so I'm again focusing on certain scenarios where we're achieving net zero, we're achieving on a certain pathway. The more things I use electricity for directly, the less electricity I need overall. So there's huge uncertainty bands. Explaining that for a minute, if I don't electrify something and instead I use a fuel that in a net zero world I have to create with electricity, engineer, thermodynamic laws, okay? You can't get something for nothing. You can't even get that. No exceptions. That's the first three laws of thermodynamics. So how much electricity you need really depends on how you change your end use sectors. So if you increasingly use fuels instead of electricity in a lot of cases, you will need more electricity to get to those net zero pathways in the future. Now, around electricity, we are able to economically use it for a lot more applications than we did before. It's still not universal, and I would actually, the idea of electrifying everything actually doesn't bear out in scenarios. It's electrify everything that makes sense to electrify, which is probably everything in our homes, unless I'm in the eastern and western fjords of Iceland and a lot of other places of the world. But it's not everything in our industry. It's probably not our planes, especially for long haul, like those batteries, again, physics, you can't lift off, which is a problem. And then ships, it just doesn't make a ton of sense because we have other alternatives that make a lot more cost sense. Mm. So how far we electrify, though, within all the caveats I just said, will determine how much electricity we need with that counterintuitive result we see in scenarios. In the U.S., like, and in other parts of the world, including developing economies, it almost certainly will be more. But to the primary energy supply comment, that primary energy supply can go down as we increase efficiency or electricity use because of efficiency gains that we have, and we're not wasting a lot of energy in those conversion processes. Hope that makes sense. If not, I will be here for drinks and I can go through it in great detail. Do you mean we get electricity being stuck at 80% zero carbon? Is that what you're talking about?
Stock prices.
Stock prices.
Stock okay. market.
Look into the finance beside me. Look into the finance beside me and on the other side.
So.
Yeah, so if you guys don't follow Stuart Russell at Berkeley, this Professor Stuart Russell, you should really follow that work because it's fascinating. Yes, we focus in on like how much electricity demand we're going to think about in AI centers. We focus less on how much efficiency we can gain from using AI and to the long time scales we're talking about in these scenarios. One of the most interesting impacts of AI that Professor Russell and others will highlight is actually the ability of AI to support education. So picture this. Current AI systems can provide a personalized tutor for every single person in the world for their entire life. What does that do in terms of population impacts? What does that do in terms of workforce retraining around not just the energy transition, but all across the economy? And what does that do to overall energy demand? I am a woman. If I am more educated, I statistically will have fewer kids. What does that do overall? So there's a lot of interesting dynamics. So we can focus in on data centers in the short term, but I would expand the AI picture to much more than that, actually. And it's a great beers conversation or sparkling water, whatever your choice is. I think we had another.
Yeah, we're using a lot of electricity to mine bitcoins. And
yeah.
I think EIA got into a legal issue involved in trying to study that. And the amount of electricity that's going to be needed for artificial intelligence also looks like it's going to be very high. It was, so we, you know, that's where I come back to. It's like we keep looking for ways. Let me just give you another simple one. There's lots of places in the world that don't have air conditioning. And if you want to improve people's lives, you know, you can get electric lights, electric refrigerators, and electric air conditioning. So where is that electricity going to come from is a big issue. But it's another one of these. It is an equity and kind of justice issue. Is there are people in the world that don't have a lot of energy, and they deserve more, not just want more. They deserve more.
And I'll drop and leave this comment as we go to the next question. Sorry, Gloria. Which is, as we depend on more electricity for more things, the impacts of ever having a blackout, either long or short, increase. And so how do we create that system that is flexible in addition to being sufficient? I describe it as a backbone. You want to be strong, but it has to be flexible or you cannot do the things you want to do in your daily life. And so we have to think about that all over the world. During a blackout, I can go to my car and keep myself warm if it's during a snowstorm because I have...
Charge your iPhone battery.
I can charge my iPhone. I can keep in touch. My car is already electric. But what happens when all of our cars are electric in a hypothetical future? Or just when more things are. And so that blackout affects more things. I can't heat water on my stove. So the impacts of those things become even more important. And so you just have to invest in your systems differently. That's not a don't electrify, far from it. It's a be conscious of the trade-offs of what you're doing and invest appropriately.
Well, we have a lot of questions. Okay, sir, could you state your name and affiliation? And please ask a question. We're running a little low on time, and I want to make sure I can get to as many questions as possible.
Sure, I always do my questions in form of questions. I'm Bill Hederman with CSIS Maxwell School Joint Program. I was surprised that we didn't talk about a price on carbon in this discussion. But I haven't seen the forecast yet, so it might be clearly stated there already. But for so much of what you're talking about, if we're going to move from directive-based innovation to market innovation, we got to find a way to get that reward from reducing the carbon or extracting the carbon. Wondering whether that's off the table as a serious discussion item now, the price on carbon, or not. So I just was interested in the panel's.
I mean, so in all these scenarios, there is either a direct or an implied carbon price, right? Because you are like, of all the scenarios that are trying to go towards net zero. So. You either get a shadow price, as we describe in the modeling, where it's the result of, you know, hitting a certain target, or it's something that you implicitly put in there. So it's exogenously defined and you run with it and see how far it gets you. It's not off the table in a lot of parts of the world. In other parts, it is off the table for now, next year, who knows. There's also the discussion that I find super interesting, which I'll give credit to my colleague I mentioned earlier, Noah Kaufman, which is, it's not an or conversation, it's an and conversation, or it can be. So you can complement a modest carbon price with other policies and accelerate things. It doesn't have to be the one-stop shop fix-all. Like, it can be sort of a team sport with a lot of different types of policies. Incentivize innovation, incentivize deployment, streamline a lot of things, provide opportunities, and have an increase in carbon price over time. That acknowledges equity issues within it, because you don't want to hurt the people who can least afford to be hurt in this when it comes to economics. I can pay 50 more bucks on my electricity bill because I'm privileged. One in three Americans already struggles to pay those bills. So you can't make that worse. Ideally, you want to make it better, I think it's fair to say. So it comes in.
Bill, I want to compliment you on using the word carbon price rather than carbon tax. You know, I think there's a lot of different ways to get a price on carbon. Melissa kind of covered that. You know, you could do it through regulation, or you might actually do it through that somebody comes up with a product that consumers want to buy that involves carbon, you know, like carbon fiber something. And I think ultimately this comes back to the discussion that Melissa and I were having earlier about, you know, are we going to really reduce the amount of carbon fuels that we have? And it's like, we might not have to if we had carbon dioxide and enough hydrogen, we could use the hydrogen and the carbon dioxide to create synthetic fuels and still be able to benefit from, you know, you could fly airliners on synthetic fuels and still reduce carbon content. I know it sounds like a little bit like Buck Rogers, but I think ultimately, you know, we have until between 2050 and 2021 to try to get there, and I pray we will.
Oh, pushing back though, 2050 to 2100 doesn't mean we don't start today. So we can't just keep business as usual and then just like turn off the lights.
I agree with that.
Okay, I think I knew you did. So okay.
State your name and affiliation and ask a question.
Sure thing. Hi, I'm Michelle Bowman from Energy Information Administration. I started with Adam about the same day, actually. I wanted to ask, I guess this is kind of like a RFF question. Have you guys thought about doing more of a modeling or technical look at the models that go into these outlooks? So looking at the back end of the lines and understanding the assumptions behind the models, the structures behind the models, the granularity that these models run at, what the data sources are, how they impute missing data, what technologies and sectors that they cover, because I think having that kind of information would be incredibly informative as your target. I love the word harmonize, but I think that's a missing piece of the harmonization puzzle, because it's understanding like, oh, this model assumes this or solves this way. That's gonna be completely different than another model, even if the policy assumptions are the same. So I was just curious if you guys have thought about that.
Okay, I'll tend to be on the panel for a moment. The short answer is we've taken a shallow dive into that and not a deep dive. So we publish a methodology report alongside our main report each year. It'll be up on the website in a couple days, and it provides a lot of detail on the types of assumptions that we look at and the types of parameters we include. But we haven't gone all the way as deep as you're describing. It would be great to do that in the future.
Yeah, and I'll highlight one issue in existing models, and I'll highlight, you mentioned small modular reactors. I'll go into nuclear. Very often in these models, even if they are the same type of optimization class, they'll have one or maybe two categories for nuclear in the back in the inputs that they put in. There's a cost, a construction timeline, a certain set of parameters on performance, and that is not accurately representing where the technology is today, much less where it can go. And it also doesn't bring in grid constraints to the degree it can in those types of models. And so it is a significant issue, which goes back to who said it? You want your model to be useful, or all models are wrong. Some are useful. Thank you. And if anyone can tell me who the quote comes from, it wasn't me, but I love it. Say it again.
Yogi Bear.
Oh, it's definitely Yogi Bear.
Good guess.
I love it. But we have to be real and transparent about these things so that we can then push at it and change stuff.
Okay. Just a quick follow-up, actually, if I can, because that's a good question. One of the scenarios that was included was the IEA a scenario. Obviously, it's come under attack. The organization has come under attack for pushing too hard, I guess, in the favor of clean energy. So I'm curious about how you think about, you know, the inclusion of what scenarios, you know, what organizations, what scenarios are included in these models, and how do you account for any sort of, you know, leanings in particular, or bias of any sort?
I mean, I think that step one is acknowledging that scenarios, not forecasts, and what was the intention of it. So the intention of like a net zero scenario from the IEA was, if we want to get there, let's talk about
a pathway, because there are endless pathways that we could take, what is a pathway to get there that gives us just rules of thumb? Like in all the scenarios, we're using more renewables. You went through this in your slides, right? We probably, hashtag slight caveat, are using more nuclear, or at least about the same. There's that one scenario at the bottom that, you know, we can talk about. But within that, one thing is, in all models, the modeler is represented to some degree. Being transparent about it helps us to be honest and let each other push against our biases that we may not realize are in there, which is why RFS inclusion of so many different types of scenarios is an important one, because we're just looking for rules of thumb. We're not saying it is five in the future. We're saying it's positive, probably really positive, and not negative in terms of increasing renewables use, probably not decreasing. But models, again, are just useful tools to tell us direction of travel and identify potential issues. They are not truth-telling crystal balls. That's not what they're meant to be. So in the IEA, I won't get into the politics of it. I won't get into the inner workings and funding models or anything else with my, you know, the former place I used to work. It is meant to start conversations. I guess in this case, it really did. So win? And if that was your goal, then it was a win. I wasn't in the room to determine what the goals were with different reports, so I can't say that.
So, Gloria, Daniel, when he talked about the ambitious climate scenarios, he mentioned that they are backcasts rather than forecasts. I don't think he used the term backcast, but I think that
that's they are.
Okay. And I think it's just, it's critical, I think, that when scenarios are presented, that kind of issue, which is really important, is highlighted, and so that everybody understands. If you look at a lot of the headlines after the IEA's net zero forecast was published, it said IEA forecasts and as Melissa said and Daniel said, they weren't. I mean, it was a backcast. It was assuming where they wanted to be and then working back towards how you could get there, and some of the conclusions that people drew from that, like that there shouldn't be any more investment in oil and gas, was really unfortunate. I don't think it was what the IEA intended, but it was, that's how it was interpreted by a lot of people.
Indeed. I think we have time for one more quick question. go ahead.
Yes, I've been monitoring questions from the online community. Thank you for sending in so many great questions. Can't get to all of them. Many of them ask some version of, is any of this realistic when it comes to the ambitious climate scenarios? So can you speak to that? Can you offer maybe examples of things that are happening in the real world that tell us how realistic or unrealistic some of these ambitious climate scenarios are?
Hmm. Well, I already mentioned the way we drove the cost down associated with wind and solar was really pretty amazing. And I think that we just have to do that with a number of other technologies in order to make progress on this. I think that are these scenarios realistic? I don't think they're meant to be realistic. They're meant to educate you on how things might look different under different sets of policy assumptions. And that's like really critical. If you're a policymaker, you need a wide range of inputs like that, I think, to help you as the policymaker push the, you know, a good solution. I want to emphasize something that you said, Dan, just a few minutes ago. I don't think there's a single pathway. That was, you know, one of the other issues associated with the net zero scenario from the IEA, presented a single pathway, and I think there are many pathways towards net zero, and that different companies and countries are going to pursue different ways of getting there.
Do you want to say something? I'll bring it home. Or you
go ahead.
So realistic. So I'll just say a quick, very quick story. It's 9 years ago now. I wrote down a list of things I thought I would see happen. I'm looking at Daniel, but it's the people online I'm looking at. What I thought could happen in the next 15 years, and I wrote down a whole list. And I said at the bottom, a caveat, paraphrased, said, I'm being optimistic, but you know what? I like that I'm an optimist, so forget about it. I'm gonna just write this list out. It's only for me anyway. within 7 years, we'd blown past every single thing on that list. So in half the time, we'd blown past everything. That's pretty incredible. Cost declines, deployments, wow. What these scenarios tell us is the degree of ambition and action that is needed if we want to achieve certain goals. There's a lot of that is up in the air around leadership, around getting all of the different ducks in a row so that we can move quickly to an outcome. If we don't get those ducks in a row sooner rather than later, then the endpoint gets out of sight really quick. But two things. One, getting to net zero, don't forget we have to stay at net zero after that. And the faster the better when it comes to a public health perspective, if that is our goal. So those scenarios, if that was the kind of footnote on those questions, they are possible but increasingly difficult. And that's just a reality. So are we going to get our ducks in a row or not if we want to get there?
One other comment. Melissa's triggering this. There are, I mean, people have looked at the wedges that you need to do in order to achieve the desired reduction in greenhouse gas emissions. And I remember, this is some time ago, 20 years ago, I looked at it, and I, from a civil engineering standpoint, I was saying, you know, there's going to be a lot of civil engineering that's going to be necessary in order to achieve this. One way of getting rid of a gigaton of carbon dioxide is to double the nuclear capacity in the United States. That'll get you a gigaton. Another way to do that is to double fuel efficiency of the automobile fleet from 20 years ago. We're actually kind of going that way. I mean, you know, that so that answers that question of, is it realistic? Yeah, we kind of, we're on the way of doing that for cars. We haven't done it for nuclear yet. And, you know, and then could we, you know, another way of getting rid of a gigaton is to do a lot of forestry activities. So, you know, it was a lot of land, I recall. It was, you know, like one of the western states would have to be covered with forests, and you could get a gigaton. Similarly, if you wanted to get a gigaton with solar, cover one of the western states with solar panels. So we're going to cover a lot of building, you know, building tops with solar panels. And so, yeah, we're making progress, but it's slow, but we have to keep at it because it's important.
How long?
Okay, the hook has come out.
How long did it take? Dwight Eisenhower ordered the construction of the interstate highway system in 1955 or six? I think it was done a decade later, pretty much, right?
Well, I don't know. We're still building it.
Well, I'm going to stop us right there and say thank you. We are standing between our guests and drinks, and we don't want to do that any longer. Everybody, let's please thank our panel, Gloria, Adam, Melissa, and Ken. Let me close us with a couple final remarks. There will be a QR code that you'll be able to scan to take a survey. Thank you so much for doing that. This event has been recorded. It'll be available soon on the RFF website, where you can also find a copy of the report and our interactive data tool. Thank you so much for our panelists. Thank you so much to Richard Newell, who has left the building, but it's kind of appropriate since he's leaving the building in a month or so. Thank you so much to RFF supporters who make this event and other events possible. You can learn how to support us at rff.org. And with that, let's all go talk some more. Thank you. Yuchi.